It's always worth another attempt. These times, a call for it. Another attempt here. I've talked about right brain, left brain. Fact is the right brain seduces the left brain, or it deceives it, it manipulates it. What the right brain says to the left brain is, find me an answer. Find me an answer. I don't have an answer. I need an answer. And so the left brain is just all this conceptualizing activity that puts stuff into answer form for the right brain. So when I say extreme right brain, I mean past this whole dichotomy right brain, left brain, which is really two sides of one coin. It really might be said brainless. Extreme right brain, brainless, because we are not after answers, actually. We're after remembrance. Remembrance is not an answer. You might say the brain is not involved in remembrance. It's not involved. Neither the right brain or left brain is involved. But we use the term extreme right brain as at least some reference. But again, the right brain is not the good guy or the good girl. No, it's the one that says, hey, I need an answer, and impels the left brain to constantly be thinking, okay, what is the answer? Does reality need an answer? Does reality need someone to point out the answer? Does reality need someone to point out what it is? So you might say the complete absence of an answer is the way to be reminded, or is reality, or the way to be reminded of reality is to experience that which is answer-free, concept-free. And this is the vision of Christ, vision of the Christ child, the vision of seamlessness. So that your perception, everything that is perceived, does not cause any interruption in the perceiving. There's some sort of steady state that is simply so beautiful and blissful. It reminds us of reality. But within that steady state, there's no answer to be found, because there's no question. There's no question, there's no answer. So we're not after answers. We're after this steady state of vision. And that is not an answer, it's a reminder of reality. So we're dropping everything that we thought was an answer. Because reality, again, there's no questions, so there's no answers. So we need to be reminded of that. Again, we have never left reality. And so at some point, we have to accept this fact. Okay? It's not how did we get back to reality. It's that we never left. So there is no answer to the question, well, how did we get back to reality? There's no answer. The way we're trying to do it, we're trying to find this answer. There isn't any. What we need to do is get a reminder of reality, and at some point we'll realize, oh, we never left. We only dreamed that we left, but we never left at all. But we need this intermediate step of vision prior to this acceptance. So what we're doing here is simplifying the situation, which is absolutely necessary, because there's way too much philosophical fine points out there. It's like a vast swamp. You don't want to get lost in that vast swamp. So don't be in a hurry for answers here. We're not getting to the answer. We're getting to the answer-free condition, actually. Which, as I say, you need to be a little stupid to be enlightened. You need to be a little bit dumb. Because people say, oh, you found the answer? Say, no. There's no answer. You don't need an answer. You need a remembrance. there's this great struggle going on. Last night I had this dream of again seeing the remedy, seeing that what the remedy was. And again, it is exactly as you are right now, in with everything exactly as it is right now, without changing anything in the world, accepting the outpouring of grace, the grace of vision, upon your perception. That is the remembrance. The only answer you can talk about is an answer involving the continuity issue. That's it. And that is this vision. This outpouring of grace upon perception, where no matter what happens to form, somehow it doesn't cause any disturbance in the seamlessness of this perception. So we only have to abide in this perception. Ramana called the self. In this perception, we only abide in that. Not thinking there's some other answer that can be given. This is the way. This is the way. But the ego always asks for more. It says, "Well, okay, it's great, but you know what?" And another question arises. You can't answer the ego's questions. Because the ego's questions are based on what if. This is what's, it doesn't, ego doesn't say this, but that's its premise. You should preface all the questions that people ask, well, what if, what if, what if this didn't work? I mean, ego basically come to you and say, well, that's great. You have this vision, and that's great. But what if it didn't work? What can you say to that? What can you say to that? And there's no answer, you know. What if it doesn't work? There are no what ifs in reality. So you might say, well, there are no what ifs in reality. So I don't need to entertain this whim, actually. It's kind of like saying, well, what if you entertained a whim? I say, well, if you entertained a whim, you'd be asking, what if you entertained a whim? That's what you'd be doing. That's all you'd be doing. So in whatever condition the world appears, whatever age, whatever condition, all that has to be done is simply allow the steady state, seamless vision, seamless perception to arise. And then that reminds one of reality. It has nothing to do with what age you live in, where in the world you live, or anything at all. It's always the same. Any form at all. Any form. This is all just a dance of impermanence, actually. You simply have this vision, seamless vision. Which means everybody can do this right now. There are no pre-requirements. This is a gift of grace. It's not, you don't earn it. It's given to us because we are one with reality. We are reality. We never left reality. This is our inheritance. So it's given to everybody. It's within everybody, this vision. God placed it there. Prime Creator placed it there as a way to solve the continuity problem. So again, you have to, on the ego standpoint, you have to appear, except the ego will say you're stupid, you're too dumb to understand these questions, is what the ego will say. The ego will say, well, boy, you're just dumb. I mean, you don't understand what my question's about. Yes, we do. It's about what if this way didn't work. It's what if God was not God, you know. And that's not a question, that's a whim. And entertaining whim is simply to ask this question of what if we entertained whim, you know. It doesn't go anywhere. It's not really a question. It's just a whim. Is a whim a question? No, it's not. Is reality being questioned? No, it's not. It's really just a whim, and it's being put into the form of a question. But there aren't, reality's not being questioned at all. So if reality's not being questioned, why are we seeking for an answer? To seek for an answer actually reinforces the notion that there's a, that reality is being questioned. It's not being questioned. It's a whim. A whim is not a question. A whim is caprice. It's spirit saying, hey, what if I could be prime creator? What if I could change the direction of creation? What if I could be prior to spaciousness, prior to creation? What if? That's just a whim. It's not a question. But all these questions here that we keep rising is just a way of trying to empower the whim. But you can't empower a whim. There's nothing there. It's not a start at all. A whim is not a beginning or a start or an ending. It's nothing. It's nothing but just one tiny instant. And that's it. With no other instant attached to it whatsoever. And instants are not attached, actually, to one another. So a whim is just one instant, and then that's it. And it's gone, just like that. So you might say we're living in the memory of that one little instant. So I know that the mind, the brain will try to say, well, how does this all relate to all the other teachings? How does it relate? There's no need to relate it at all. How does seamlessness relate to whim? Does something need to relate to reality? Do we need to relate to reality? Really? Does reality need to relate to itself? I mean, there's some it need to relate? No, that's again whim, whimsical. Whimsicality. Whimsicality cannot relate to reality at all. It keeps trying to say, no, I can relate to it because I'm prior to it, so it came from me, so I should be able to relate to it. But what whim says is reality should be able to relate to whim. So what we're really doing here is we're insisting, no, reality needs to relate to whim. And so we have all this impermanence, right? This dream of impermanence is Spirit's way of saying, I want reality to relate to whim, to conform itself to whim. And so we have this dream of conformity to whim. But it's nothing. It's nothing. It's just a dream. It's just a desire. So all the philosophical splitting hairs and everything like that, that's just a distraction. It's just a distraction, actually. It's like saying, well, how did reality become real? That's a whimsical question, again. Or how did we manage to fix reality? Or how did reality get healed from whim? All these kinds of things. So you have to keep this kind of consideration going, which just simply points you to the seamless perception as the answer, as the constant pouring out of grace upon perception of everything. It's not like you're perceiving and you see something and say, oh, I don't want grace there, you know, or something like that. No, it's a seamless pouring out. And if this is being heard, it should be producing like this sort of an ache within, like a deep sort of like a little bit of frustration, a little feeling, like a little struggle. It's like, but something is like, you feel like, you know, you're getting to the root of it actually. We are getting to the root of it here, no question about it. And so that should have an effect, like a, feel some resistance to this actually. But there's, what I would say is that looking at what I've been through, there's a time when this kind of talk produces too much resistance and you have to shut it down. And then there's a time where, like now, this produces some resistance, but it's not enough to tip the balance to shutting down at all. So I'm able to keep on looking at this, even though inside there's like an you know, like that. it doesn't interfere. I can just feel it, but it's not getting in the way. Question. They're saying, "Oh, wait a minute, wait a minute. I want to ask a question. I want to ask a question. I need an answer. I need an answer." Again, whimsicality is the key phrase, I would say, is the key word, which is left out of most teachings. I can't find it. And this is a great oversight, in my opinion. The reason why I'm doing these, sharing these teachings, is because I find they're better. I like them better than the other teachings that I've come across, which is a lot. For me, the key concept is whimsicality, not insanity, not anything. Whimsicality of spirit, capriciousness, adventurousness, gone overboard, saying, "Hey, you know, I want this. Can I have the supreme adventure? I want the supreme adventure." So all of existence, this is supposedly the supreme adventure, but it's nothing but an instant of whim, actually. And so all these questions that are rising, again, are not even questions at all. There's nothing to them. So I'm getting hit by what I've said here in the video, strongly, because it rings true to me. It absolutely rings true. Just wow. Very hard hit. Which is good. That's great. That's what you want. You want to spend time with whatever hits you really hard in this way. If something isn't hitting you hard in this way, then find something that does. It kind of just like stops you in your tracks. And there's part of momentum. It's like you're stopping your tracks and there's still this momentum within you, right, that wants to keep going. But you've stopped. And so you kind of feel this inner kind of like urge to keep going. But you're not continuing to keep going like this. And so there's this feeling inside of you like, wow, part of me wants to keep going, but it's been stopped. And it's reverberating now. It's like it can't go any further, you know, there's this temporary feeling. This is just mind-blowing type of thing. This is just a dream of whimsicality, of how reality conforms to whimsicality. Oh my gosh. I've never thought of that before. That is just... And so we're so used to this dream, this whimsical farce of supposedly the confirmation of reality to the priorness of whimsicality, that again we have a continuity issue. We don't know what to do with it. We don't know. We're afraid to set it down. So this vision from the grace of the Prime Creator, giving us a seamless, steady experience, instead of all this ragged up and down of this confirmation, supposed imaginary confirmation of reality with whimsicality. Because really, our lives are like a whimsical farce, really. I mean, everybody tries to put some sort of meaning to existence. It's not like that. You know, we keep thinking to pose order upon the universe and meaning, and this is all meaningful. It's not like that at all. It's all capricious. It's all whimsical. It's all topsy-turvy, and you know, there's what we need to be reminded of reality is this steady state, a steady state. But how do you get a steady state in this madcap farce of existence? I'm driving yesterday and somebody almost smashed into the side of me. They completely lost track of their lane and thought my lane was where they're supposed to be going. In the last second they saw it, I saw it, and they saw it. It's like, wow, they're totally distracted. You know, why are they so distracted? People are so distracted in driving right now. I look at people, and almost, you know, half the people are, you know, looking down. I saw somebody in the freeway just weaving back and forth, and I passed, and I look, and he's like, you know, looking at a tablet, and he's pounding and stuff, and he looks up, and then he goes back to the tablet, and he looks up, you know, and you know, it's this mad dance. You know, if you look at the world, and people are desperately trying to impose some sort of meaning upon the world, but it really doesn't have a meaning. Does whim have a meaning? That's the question. No, it's the denial of meaning. So we're trying to, having a dream of conforming reality with no meaning, with chaos, I guess you'd say, you know. So how do we perceive this in a way that reminds us of reality? That's the question, right? And the means that we're using now to perceive it are self part of the whim, variable, unreliable, vulnerable, all of that. There's another perception that comes from the Holy Spirit, which is not based on the body's eyes. So the body's eyes can still see everything move, but no matter what perception, what matter what our perception lights upon, it doesn't affect this bliss at all. Now, we may still have the variable experiences in physical sensory perception, but it doesn't affect the bliss at all. And we notice that, and we say, hey. And then we say, wait a minute, this is capricious, and this is non-capricious. And we begin to recognize the difference between the two. All these efforts to develop, that's actually what happens, is we're so caught up in this whimsicality that we are not able to really get a handle on it initially. And so we have to play along with it and try to develop, become a better person and all this kind of stuff, until we reach a point where we realize that doesn't work. And then when we realize it doesn't work, then we say, okay, what does work? And we don't get upset that we've wasted our time. We say, I needed to do that to see that it didn't work, so that I can now say for sure this doesn't work, and now I can do what does work. So that's why you have the apex teaching. That's why you have whatever, but don't even call it that. You don't even need to call it that. we can dispense with those terminologies, actually. You don't have to call it anything. But you can dispense with teachings. You can dispense with efforts. You say that none of that works. None of it doesn't work. And then you can come to the use of pragmatic, of what actually works. So you have to then, you appear stupid to those who are still trying to, you know, impose some sort of meaning upon the world, and order, and answers, or coming up with all these answers, so many, many answers. They're not coming up with any answers, actually. They're just reinforcing a question, as if whimsicality is a questioning of reality. It's not. So I would say it's the best way is to focus on the root, which is whimsicality, and its so-called relationship with reality. It's really non-relationship with reality, and its claimed relationship with reality. Examine this claim of whimsicality. Ramana would say it's the I, but it's a whimsicality of spirit. Where did this come from? Does it really have a relationship with reality? Does reality have a relationship with it? You know, this sort of questioning absolutely nullifies other considerations. It's so important that all the rest of the stuff, it just fades away. You don't have to make it fade away. It just fades away on its own. Which is what the great sages have said, as Ramana said. If you focus on this, he calls it, quote unquote, the I. I've never thought of it that way, but that's one way of saying it. But it's really, again, spirit choosing to be whimsical. Okay, that's what it really is. And to say, hey, what if, I want to be prior to reality. I want there to be a priorness to reality, and this whimsical desire is what we call I, as it were, a supposedness of a questioning of reality, a relationship. It's really the desire for there to be a relationship between reality and whim. That's how I put it right now. It's simply a desire that there be a relationship between reality and whim. Is there a relationship? So the question of what is the I is really saying, is there a relationship between reality and a whim, that there be something prior to reality? Is there a relationship there? There's not. But examine that. And in looking directly at that, all these other questions, suppose, they're all contingent upon this. So when you're looking at this, these things are out of the picture for now, because you're saying, oh, wait a minute. You know, maybe there's no relationship, which means that all these questions, contingent questions, are nothing. Irrelevant. So why spend time trying to find answers to irrelevant questions? You can certainly pursue answers, but they're always going to be irrelevant. So is an irrelevant answer an answer, is the question you can ask. Something to consider. Is an irrelevant answer, is that an answer? It's not relevant to anything. So how can we say it's an answer? It's really just desire continuing the charade that there can be a question, that reality is questionable. In other words, that we can say, well, what if there was something prior to reality? Is that a question? Is that a question, or is it a whim? So we think we have all these questions, but what we really have is just one whim. And again, does a whim need an answer? Well, from a pragmatic standpoint, we have a continuity issue. So that does require an answer. But it's not the whim that requires an answer. It's the continuity issue. So this is something, this teaching for me makes things way easier than the teachings in the past, which have become so truncated and attenuated and so, you know, wow. You can spend a lifetime slogging through that stuff and still feel like you've got nowhere. It's like, forget it. You know, you just condense it right down to these few issues, and that's it. Look straight at that. Is a whim, ask yourself, is a whim a question of reality? Is a whim asking a question of reality? Or is it just a petulant demand? Is it really a question? If there's no question there, why do we need an answer there? We don't need an answer there, but we do need an answer to the continuity problem. So the situation is we overlook the continuity problem because the ego, you know, keeps us overlooking it. So we feel like we need an answer, right? And so we keep thinking we need an answer to the whim, as if it's questioning reality. And so we're misplacing this desire for an answer, misplacing it. And that's what drives our seeking for answers. But if you put the question where it rightfully belongs, which is on the continuity problem, in other words, how is the continuity problem solved, then all these other considerations and questions don't really arise at all. They don't arise. They're just like they recede into the shadows like unimportant. They're just shadows. So a whim is not questioning reality. It's just a desire to be prior to reality. But that's not a questioning of reality. That's just a whim, a desire, a whim. It's different. And we're trying to ennoble this whim by all the speculations and questions and stuff like that. Taking it seriously. Can't take it serious. Don't take it seriously. Dismiss it and say, okay, but the continuity problem is a serious issue. How do I remember reality after spending all this time believing in whim? With all this time with desire. Whimsical desire. Seeing this vast play of imagined conformity with whim, as if this is reality and reality has now been conformed to whim. That spending all this time with that, how do we drop that? And then again, we need this steady perception of this ridiculous dance. And to answer the question, why is nature so mischievous? You know, why really? Because it's a dream of reality conforming with whim, as if whim is now the prime creator prior to reality, and now reality needs to learn to conform to whim. So we see this as a process, existence as a process of reality conforming to a whim, this whim of a priorness, prior to reality. And it's needing to learn how to conform. So it's in the process of conforming. It's all nothing. Just a madcap farce. So again, nothing has to be solved about this conforming to reality of existence, or conforming to whim. You know, reality's not actually trying to conform to whim at all. Never has been, in the slightest bit. This is all just a dream. A dream that reality is conforming to whim, but it's not. So continuity issue arises. Steady vision of steadiness. Again, a hole in a tire, but the air in an air pump pumping air into the tire balances out the pressure in the tire, and the pressure stays exactly the same. Okay, pressure, no matter how many holes come in the tire. The grace of God keeps the pressure exactly the same. So you might call it the vision of equal pressure, I would say. It's almost really like an atmospheric thing. It's a felt atmospheric feeling, like there's equal pressure everywhere. Imagine if you have a bicycle or a car, you have a flat tire, and yet there's a compressor that pumps air into the tire, and it keeps the pressure at 32, or say 33, let's say 33 pounds of pressure. No matter how many holes are in the tire remains at perfectly equal pressure. And so we're in this world of this imaginary process of conformity to whim, reality conforming to whim, and all this capricious, farcical impermanence, dance of deathness is happening constantly, and yet we are feeling the steady pressure, absolutely immaculate steady pressure, which is called bliss. The steady pressure is called bliss. That's what we're experiencing. Because again, why do we need to experience a dream of reality conforming to whim? For what purpose? It's completely useless. Totally useless. You might say this world is completely useless. And yet, there is this continuity issue. So, steady pressure. Whether you're in heat or cold, turmoil, calmness, whatever, the pressure remains the same. Now the ego says, you don't need this, you can just go to the Hawaiian Islands, the same temperature all the time. that's its answer. That's the answer of whim would say, I'll just go to Hawaii, that's all you need, just hang out there. Only problem is there when the locals come and put the pressure on you to leave. do you continue to feel this perfect equal pressure or not? No, you don't. So, going to Hawaii is not the answer. Again, that's saying, hey, as a whim saying, hey, there's something in this dream of reality conforming to whim. There's some place out there which has what you want. It's everything's fine. Just go to that place and you'll be fine. No, because you're still entirely within the experiencing this dream of conformity. And of course, that place you'll get kicked out. You'll get sick. You'll suffer all sorts of indignities and death, etc. So, again, whim saying that there's some place where you can go for the answer is not the same as saying right where you are you can accept equal pressure, vision of equal pressure. Called equanimity. What is equanimity? Pressure. Really, the whole universe is just a pressure differentials, actually. That's how I see it. Electricity is just a pressure differential. Energy, that's all it is. It's just pressure differentials. Just one big pressure system, and you put different differentials of pressure, more here, less here, etc. And the dance is just a dance of pressure. And so equal pressure, vision of equal pressure, this feeling of equal pressure, no matter what is dancing, that you feel this equal pressure is the grace of God constantly balancing it out perfectly without any effort on our part. So everywhere is like Hawaii. You have this perfect microclimate with you, as it were, pressure. Portable paradise. So the portable paradise is what we're aiming for. right, so hopefully this is like hit hard, but not overwhelming. And it's just like you feel like stopped in your tracks, the momentum towards finding answers is suddenly, you know, the brakes have been hit hard. And you say, well, wait a minute, I don't really need to. It's all right in front of me. It's all right here, right in front of me, now, right now. And so your plans, Jesus always said, what I've got from him is, don't make any plans for the future. He always said that, don't make any plans for the day, for the future, etc. And that's what I do, I don't make any plans. People say, do you have plans for the weekend? I just say, not really. I get up in the morning, I have no plans for anything. And this is important, because our plans are really, are seeking for answers. And we've got all this momentum going. And we have all this momentum going, it's very difficult to hit the brakes and say, oh, wait a minute, all I need is this steady vision of steady equanimity, steady equal pressure. That's it. And all this existence is just a desire for a dream of reality in the process of conforming to whim. And there's nothing there. It's meaningless. Yeah. So the whole thing is, the answer is right here, right now. That's hard to accept when you are projecting the answer into the future by all your plans. Okay, I need to go there, do this, do that, do that, do that, do that, do that, do that. Your entire psyche is geared toward the future, of finding it in the future. Whereas for me, I don't place any emphasis at all, really, on finding it in the future. Try not to. Some are to say, what are you going to do the rest of the day? I'm totally clueless. Not even thinking about it. Now, at some point, I'll have to get up and go grocery shopping or whatever. You know, something will arise. They have to take care of stuff, and I'll do it. But I don't think beyond that either. What am I going to do next? I try not to think, what am I going to do next? It's a tough discipline, because certainly you'll seem to be not succeeding like other people. But actually, you're actually totally succeeding, which is seeing the all-inclusive remedy right now for this entire capricious, whimsical dream, which is the solving the continuity problem, the resolution of the continuity problem, which is remembrance of reality, which is steady state, steady pressure, portable paradise, which reminds us of reality, that reality is unquestioned, has no questions, has no whimsicality to it. It's not conforming itself to something other. It's not in the process of learning how to conform to something prior to it. But we need to be reminded of this other, because in this world, there's constant changes in pressure on us, subtle and all gross and subtle. There's all constant flux of pressure differentials, which we call the dance of energy, dance of Maya. And that doesn't remind us of reality at all. Totally alien to reality, totally alien to it. So, continuity issue, how do we go from what is totally alien to reality to accepting that reality has always been the way that it is, that there never was any prior to it. Reality never reacted or responded to this whim at all. And how do we accept that? First, steady state of pressure here in the world, steady state vision of Christ child, all the same bliss, abidance in the self. It's in that steady state of pressure that we accept. And of course, in a steady state of pressure, where's the question? Where are the questions? And where are the answers? And therefore, there's no questions, no answers. There's just this steady state. That is the remedy. The remedy of remembrance. Okay? That's it for this one. Very great.